If you have your Bibles, and I hope you do, turn to the book of Numbers, chapter 13. And I'm going to pray. And I know it's midweek. I don't know what you do around here on midweek. Well, I'm pretty sure I know what you do, but I know what I do on midweek too. And I'm going to start out teaching tonight, and then I'm sure we'll pick up some steam as you're used to probably a midweek study. But I really have something on my heart that I want to share with you that I feel is for this church. I feel it's for all churches, but I really feel touched of the Lord to bring it to you tonight. So I'm going to pray first, and then I'll let you be seated, but leave your Bible open because I'm going to get to that text, and then we'll talk to you there. Amen? Will you help me pray tonight? No, I mean, will you not listen to me pray? Will you help me pray? Will you ask God to put something into your spirit tonight? God has something for you. Will you say, God, open up my heart, my soul, my mind, my spirit. Jesus, tonight, I pray earnestly, God, that you would speak to us. We have gathered in your house to hear words, but to be impacted by spirit tonight, I pray, let the anointing, let it go forth and feed and inspire. And truly, God, would you let it impact us to the point that it changes us? Take us into a different place. Help us to leave so differently than we came. I pray and ask all of this in the wonderful name of Jesus. And everybody said, in Jesus' name. Say amen. Amen. That means it is so. God bless you. You can be seated. I'm going to challenge you a little bit tonight. And I want to talk to you to go beyond where you are. I mean, would anybody like more? Okay, 7 or 8 of you want more. I mean, more of Jesus, more spirit, more touch. I want to deal with a subject tonight that amazed Jesus. It amazed him. Two different types of faith amazed him. Great faith amazed him. And lack of faith or little faith amazed him. Had the same effect. He was amazed when somebody had great faith. He made mention of it, and he was amazed when people had little or no faith. I want to have great faith. See, when it comes to our faith, there are four areas that you and I deal with that we have to overcome. These areas weaken our faith. Jesus talked about all four of them in Matthew 6:30. He said, don't worry about what you're going to eat, what you're going to wear, what kind of roof's going to be over your head. He dealt with worry. Worry eats away at our faith. Matthew 8:26, Jesus was asleep in the back of the boat. And the disciples accused him of not caring. Another area that we feel like sometimes things happen and we will charge the Lord foolishly and say, don't you care about my situation? Worry eats away at our faith. And then the care of our livelihood, the care of our flesh, the care of our situation can weaken our faith. In Matthew 14:31, Peter was walking on water, and in the middle of his miracle moment, he began to sink. He wasn't walking on water, he was walking on the word. Jesus said, come. We sink in our faith when we don't believe the word of God. When we doubt. Doubt erodes our faith. Matthew 16:18, it's kind of a funny story. Jesus had just fed the multitude, and they are in the boat, and he tells them to beware of the leaven of the Pharisees. And they mistake what he's talking about, and they begin to reason, did we forget bread? And he rebukes them. How could you not? Didn't you see what just happened? And you're gonna wonder if we need bread? I had In-N-Out trucks coming all over the place, feeding everybody, and you're worried if we're gonna have enough to eat? Human reason, logic can play in and weaken our faith. You and I as humans living in the year 2022 deal with worry, fear, doubt, and human reasoning. These can erode our faith to a place that robs us of a faith that amazes God when God has been so good. When you contrast that to great faith, two things always support great faith. Matthew 8, verse 10, and Luke 7, verse 9, talks about the centurion, submission to authority. The sign of great faith is surrender and submission. This always supports great faith, a blind trust that God's word says it, I believe it, I'm gonna act on it, I'm gonna involve myself with it, I'm gonna take it in, I'm gonna let that word become flesh in me. That supports great faith. Matthew 15, verse 28 is the story of the Syrophoenician woman. The other side that produces or supports great faith is that you can't be offended. No offense can even get in your heart because you have faith. Jesus equated somebody that can't be offended to somebody that has great faith. Psalms 119 and verse 165, great peace have they which love thy law, and nothing shall offend them. Great faith is somebody that can't be offended. I'm not going to lay out of church because I got my feelings hurt. I'm not going to get sideways with God because he's not doing it the way I think he ought to do it. I am going to submit and surrender and trust. Yes, Lord, even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table. The Lord gave her a blank check of faith because she couldn't be offended. You and I are living in a day and age, offenses are at an all-time high. The devil is trying to get you offended at the preacher, offended at your brother, offended at your sister. It weakens your faith and robs you. Are you with me? I'm trying to chew on this throat lozenge here. It's stuck in my... There we go. I'm just going to crunch it up. Did you hear that? So I can just keep on going and not be distracted. Hebrews 11, 6. Anybody quote that? I'm just being real with you. Hebrews 11, 6. But without faith, it's impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. See, you and I must understand something. Faith is a way of life for us. Are you with me? Faith is an integral part of our walk with God. God puts great importance on our personal faith. God puts great importance on our personal faith. We must believe that he is. Without faith, we can't please him personally. I'm not talking about the bishop. I'm not talking about the pastor. I'm not talking about the elders. I'm talking about everybody else, all of us. We all have personal faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please him. We must believe that he is. See, to invoke his name is to invoke his presence into whatever situation. When you and I pray in a name, it's just not some magic little genie thing, and we use a name like it's some sort of magical thing. No, to invoke the name is to invoke the God of that name and invite his presence into that situation. And when he shows up, you believe God is here. It doesn't matter. God is here. I don't care the circumstance. I don't care the situation. God is here. I believe that he is. Amen. He's a rewarder of those that push past, seek. And without it, it's impossible. So could I say it like this? We have a spiritual dependence on faith. We need it. It's part of us. It's integral. It's not some object. It's the journey of a life, of us holding on to God and trusting God and believing God and his word. And so because of this, there is a responsibility to our faith. The word responsibility means duty. You have a duty. I want to talk to you tonight about the responsibility of your faith. Not my faith, not their, your faith. You and I have a responsibility to faith, to our faith. That means we have an accountability to it. It's up to us to manage it. It's up to us to care for it. It's up to us to feed it. It's up to us to guard it. But ultimately, it's up to us to use it. I said use it. Not talk about it. Not just use it. Exercise it. We have a responsibility to our faith to engage it, to exercise it, to use it, to stretch it like a muscle. Romans 12:3 says something really interesting. It tells us that God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith. The measure. The Greek word for measure has a connotation that means usage. You could read it like this: according to how much faith you use, God will give you more. I want more faith. Well, why don't you use what you got? If you want more faith with God, start with, God said if you had the faith of a mustard seed, something that small, you could move a mountain. I would say all of us together have more faith than a mustard seed. What could we do tonight if we would engage our faith, the duty of our own faith, to engage it, to use it, to do something with it? I mean, do you think church is just coming, sitting in a row, shouting, screaming week in and week out, and not engaging our faith to teach a Bible study, to pray for somebody, to bring somebody, to talk to your neighbor, to talk to those that are around you? Are you so caught up in your own fear, in your own worry, in your own doubt, in your own human reasoning? They'd never want this. They wouldn't want. Friend, you wanted it. There are people all around us right now. The world is in chaos. They are looking for people that are full of faith and that know how to use it, engage it, do something with it. Sit down. I got to get there. I get sidetracked here. Get in that dimension. And I want to read for you our text. I said all that to set up the text. The context of the text is very simple, found in Numbers 13. Moses has led the children of Israel all the way to the promised land. You want a title? I'll tell you, I'm preaching about the responsibility of your faith. Okay? Moses has led them all the way to the promised land. The plague, splitting of the Red Sea, all the trial, Moses has decimated Egypt, the most powerful nation on the planet, with a stick and his little hand thing and Aaron and some words. He didn't come with an army, a B-52, or a few tanks. He marched in, used words, and decimated it. Wow. Powerful. Now they are standing on the border of the promises of God. The promised land. A land that flows with milk and honey. Revelation 3:8, if I'm not mistaken, says, "Behold, I set before you an open door. I'm not going to make you go through. I'm opening it. But according to your faith, are you going to walk through?" You with me? So I find this interesting, this story here. Let's read in Numbers 13, verses 1 through 3. You don't have to stand. I know usually we do. But we're meandering through. Verse 1 says, "And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, Send thou men that they may search the land of Canaan, which I give unto the children of Israel. Of every tribe of their fathers shall you send a man, every one a ruler among them." Say leader. I want you to pick the leader of every tribe, Moses, and I want you to send them into Canaan. I want them to spy out the land. And Moses, verse 3, and Moses, by the commandment of the Lord, it's established, sent them from the wilderness of Paran. All those men were heads of the children of Israel. They're leaders, right? Okay. Let's make a few observations, because if you read verses 4 through 16, you get the names of all the leaders that went. Does anybody know any of the leaders? Come on, I think there's Egal or Igal or Igor or something in there. Balti. You know, the point is nobody remembers their names. Why? Why? They gave a faithless, an evil report. Not faithless, evil. Evil. So we're like, who are they? We remember Caleb and Joshua. But the rest, who gives a rip? We don't even know their names. But they're leaders, right? Okay. Pick 12 men and send them into the promised land to scout, to explore, to spy, to experience. They brought back the goodness, grapes. We know they gave this faithless report and said, they're like grasshoppers. We are like grasshoppers in their sight. And so we thought that they thought of us like grasshoppers. I mean, that's a whole nother message in itself. I'm convinced the church really doesn't know who they are, because if you don't know who you are, you don't know what to do. When you know who you are, you know what you need to do. A police officer puts on a uniform every day and he knows his job. But I'm convinced the church doesn't know who they are, what they are, and what they have a hold of. I mean, the Bible tells me in 1 John that the Son of God was manifested, made visible for this purpose, to destroy the works of the devil. Do you realize you and I are his body? We are here to destroy the works of the devil. Wherever there's chaos, we bring peace. Wherever there's unforgiveness, we bring forgiveness. Wherever there's brokenness, we bring healing. Wherever there is the devil at work, we bring the kingdom of heaven and make it manifest. That's my purpose. That's my calling. God didn't give me the Spirit of God to sit on a pew or a church seat week in, work out, and learn how to shout and scream and not do anything with what he's invested in me. He has given each and every one of us a measure of faith. And if you want more, you got to use what you got. Then God can increase. So this is interesting to me. And why? Why did God do this? If God knew that they were going to give a faithless, evil report, why on God's green earth did he tell Moses, you pick out 12 leaders, they got to be leaders, and you tell them to go in, rulers over the tribes, you tell them to go in, scout out the land, and then come back and give a report. But God, you know they're going to give a false report. Why would you do this? Why not just have Moses say, the land floweth with milk and honey. I got a stick. I got my hand. Let's go. But they're standing at the promises of God. Can I tell you this right now, friend? One of the most dangerous places for you and I to stand is on the threshold of the promises of God. Because God's waiting to see what you're going to do. But God already knows. He already knows what you're going to do. But God wants you to know what's inside you. So I know I could say, well, why would God do this? What was the purpose of this? I know the intent of God for doing this, you could say, was to spark faith in these men. And then they would come back, give a good report, and incite and spark more faith in the rest of the congregation. And so faith then would be able to carry the congregation, the Israelites, into the promises of God. Do you notice the responsibility of their faith? Their faith. This is staggering. Their faith. 10 men kept, scholars believe, 1.5 million to 3 million people from taking hold of the promises of God because of doubt. Moses had all kinds of faith. Caleb, Joshua, they had all kinds of faith. But their faith couldn't carry them in. It was collective faith. You know the story. The faithless report found in verses 25 and 26. Doubt-filled, fearful. Again, catch this. 10 men that we don't even remember their names kept back 1 million, 3 million people from moving forward into the promises of God. May we gain some insight from this. May we gain some understanding. There is a need for collective faith. I know the preacher, the pastor, the man of God, but there is a collective faith. Do you realize there's some places we can't go unless all of us go? He can declare, the bishop can preach his guts out to you, we can inspire you, we can pull you. But I can't give you passion. I can't give you desire to pray. I can't give you passion to do the work of God. And I can't give you openness. God looks for passion, desire, but mainly he looks for openness. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone will open the door and invite me in. But God, I don't want you in because you want me to do things I'm not comfortable doing. You want to stretch me in areas that I don't want to be stretched. I'm going to leave that for ministry. I'm going to leave that for somebody else. If you want to go through the open door, if you want to step into promises, if you want to see God move like you've never seen it before, you need to engage your faith. I want you to know there are places, there are spiritual places we can't go as individuals. We can only go collectively. Can't go alone. We can only go as a church body. Are you hearing me? Some prayers, Jesus said, two or three. If two or three will agree, that implies there are some prayers you can't pray alone. There has to be the unity of those around us praying and believing. See, there is a responsibility to our faith. Again, Moses is ready, Joshua is ready, Caleb is ready, but they could not because the people of God collectively were not ready, not prepared. They had no understanding of their own responsibility to their own faith and that God was looking to them. God was counting on their faith. Hebrews 4:2 tells us, for unto us was the gospel preached as well as unto them. But the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. We hear preaching day in and day out, week in, week out. What are you doing with your faith? Why is not this house full? You have the best thing going. Your name's been written down in the Lamb's Book of Life. You've been covered in the blood. You claim the truth. You shouted and sung and worshiped. Why is not the building full? Come on. If you believed it, if you're sold out to it, if you love it, it's going to come out. I have found that some people are involved but not very committed. I read a great story right around December 7th. This is a freebie. There was a kamikaze that wrote a book. He flew over 50 missions and it said, my book on being a kamikaze. Hello? A kamikaze flies one mission. And he said in the book, I was very involved, but not very committed. I was highly involved, but I was not committed. I find there's so many church people highly involved, but nobody's got faith. Nobody's got heart. Nobody gives it their all. And because of that, God tarries. And because of that, the church is on the brink of the biggest revival. Friend, we are in a wilderness out there right now, a pandemic junk, and people are looking to the church for answers, for faith, for healing. We have the biggest revival right in front of us. And and I can preach, and he can preach, and he can preach, and we can pray. But until you engage, until all of us get the same passion, the same desire, the same openness, God, deal with my junk. I can't shout on Sunday and cuss on Monday. I gotta get committed. I gotta live it. I'm talking about faith is not an object. It's a lifestyle that grips you, that you believe, that you get a hold of. It shapes you. It moves you. You engage with it. It's not a hobby. Not something you just do. Not another piece of the pie of your lifestyle. I go to church. I'm a Christian. It's everything. It drives you. It fuels you. You live for it. It's everything about you. It pushes you. Yes. I mean, one of the most frustrating things for ministry is to be so passionate. And so, I don't know. I've been living for God since I was 19. I didn't grow up in this. 19. And I was so overwhelmed that God would give me the Holy Ghost. It's never left me. I went to church, and after being in church for a couple years, I was still so excited. I had some old brother tell me, "Don't worry, son, it'll wear off." I want you to know it's never wore off. I'm just as passionate today as I was then. Why? I'll tell you why. Can you bear this? Because my faith is alive. It's not dead. It's not dormant. I have a responsibility to steward it, to grow it, to care for it. Maybe what you need is a good praying through. God have mercy. Why is faith so important? Because faith comes by hearing. And why is church so important? Because faith comes by hearing. It's more than just something we do. Our spiritual man depends on it. Why faith is so important. God moves the church forward by faith. This is why it's such a big deal. It's the gas in the car. It's the food in your body. Faith is what propels the spiritual man. It's what edifies you. God asks of us obedience, and he asks of our faith. And if we have a responsibility to our faith, then we're going to grow it. We're not going to bury it and put it in the ground and wait for heaven to come and then say, "Wow, I buried that. I guess I should take that out." What would happen tonight if heaven crashed into earth? You know what would happen? We'd find out all the places you buried all your talents, all your faith, all your energies. And why? Well, I was afraid. I didn't think they wanted it. I didn't know they would really care about it. I didn't know God could do that in my life. On and on and on. Excuse after excuse after excuse. While your faith lays dormant and there's an open door for you to grab a hold of the promises of God, but you can't move forward, because five people with awesome faith is not the whole collective body. Is this okay? I'm telling you, this is what is needed in our day and age. We have all kinds of churches sitting on the sidelines while the pastors are wearing themselves out. Ministry going crazy, trying to keep people happy. Got a bunch of immature saints that want this, want that, upset about this, offended over here. All so distracted by the devil that we are powerless. I'm just being real with you. Told the Lord the other day, you know, if you kill a couple people, Ananias and Sapphira, great fear came on the church and the church multiplied. Now I'm being facetious. I didn't really pray, "God, kill somebody," but I thought about it. What's it going to take? See, faith is what will get us into the promises of God. See, when Israel left Egypt, again, scholars believe 1.5 million to 3 million people came out under Moses. But do you realize the start of that great move of God started with one? One man. While the lash was being laid on the back of all of those Hebrews, There was an 80-year-old man. The Bible says something so profound. It says he was content to dwell in Midian. He had let go of all the promise. He's wrapped up with potential, but he's so content just taking care of the sheep, just mowing the yard, going to the job, got a wife, got a couple kids. I'm just, why do I need to get all engaged in everything? I'm living for God. It's good. God is good. I'm old. But he finds a burning bush. And God finally speaks to him as he turns aside. When he slows down enough to actually be attentive, he sees something and he notices. I mean, how long does it take to notice that a bush is burning but not really catching on fire? It takes some attention, which this is why God spoke to him. And here he is alone. And all the dilemmas, and God's talking about his people and slavery. And Moses is like, I can't talk. I'm old. I already tried this. I did it wrong. I failed. I killed somebody. I looked to the left. I looked to the right. But I didn't look up, God. And I started my ministry with murder. Don't give me your excuses why you can't go across the street and talk to your neighbor. I've failed too many times. Good Lord. Now, if I was at home, I'd be all sweet and nice, but I'm leaving, so you can get them, but I can tell you how I feel. The church is this giant sleeping giant with more power, more potential wrapped up in her. Come on. God will never allow his past to outdo his future. But the problem is he needs collective faith. And God had an answer to delivering so many people, and that was one man. One man. One solitary man. The same is true today. God has a man. I mean, if it's Moses or Noah, Elijah, Samuel, it starts with one man alone wrestling with God, with his own faith to step out. There's a church in Paris today because God wrestled with me alone. Go do this. What? Who? Wow. I don't know how to do this kind of stuff. How can you, what, God? Wrestling. See, but the children of Israel's freedom, their bondage, the taskmasters, all of that was placed in the arms of Moses. If Moses doesn't obey the call, you got to hear this. No one gets delivered from Egypt. If Moses doesn't surrender, no one gets out of Egypt. What was it like to have the burning bush experience? The stick turns into a snake, the hand trick. You go home, you tell your wife, this is awesome. You know, like you had an incredible Sunday night, and Monday you're like, yes, but by Tuesday you're like, who is Jesus? Help me, Lord, I'm losing my way. I gotta make it till Wednesday night so I can make it for two more days to live for God. I'm barely making it. Well, if you'd pray, maybe do some fasting, how about read some word? How did Moses, with his wife saying, you did this and this, and then you got your stick turned to a snake, and you're going to go to, you're 80. You know, maybe the sun's done. Come on, Grandpa, let's go. And Moses is like, no! I had a vision of God. God spoke to me. I got a word in me. I'm going to go to Egypt. Now, how long does it take to go to Egypt? 14, 20? He's 80. He's alone. What's that journey like? Wrestling. Did I really hear God? This is crazy. I'm going to the most powerful nation on the planet by myself with a stick. Pharaoh is Colon embalmed and perfumed. I've been in the wilderness. I don't even know what deodorant is. I smell like Sasquatch.
Yes.
What was that like? To step in and stand there and declare the word of God, and Moses is flawless. Let my people go. God sent me a message. And then he gets rebuked. Pharaoh says, well, because you did this, the people are going to make bricks with no hay. Then he goes to the people. He's like, I'm so sorry. I failed you. I guess I thought I had something, but you know, maybe the sun did. The Bible says something very interesting in Exodus 6 and 9. It says, the anguish of the Egyptians' slavery over the Hebrews had caused them such emotional distress they couldn't believe the words of God. Moses is dealing with slaves that are so emotionally wrapped up in their slavery, they're more comfortable in their imprisonment than they are in stepping forth into the promises. Because you know why? Promises are freedom, and it's unknown. I am more comfortable to stay wrapped up in my imprisonment because I'm used to it. I'm acute to it. Come on, our world is so imprisoned. I got to get going here. So Pharaoh's like Pharaoh's like a type of devil. And Egypt's a type of the world. And Moses is a preacher sent to do what? Preach them out. And God gives him signs and wonders and power. He starts calling down fire. He starts getting bold. The Nile will be blood tomorrow. Oh, by the way, the frogs are coming, baby. And here they come. And Moses gets a little bit swag in his step because God now is acting on his faith because he's got usage. He's acting on what God told him. He steps into it. And God says, yes, you understand the responsibility of faith. I have imparted to you something, and you're doing something with it. And so now I will increase it, and it becomes more powerful. How would you like to pray and know that God is answering your prayer? How would you like to pray for your block and God give you the address? You don't have to go knock every door. Go down three doors, make a left. There's a man in there. He's got cancer. Him and his wife are having problems. Go take the word of God. Isn't that what Paul did?
Yes, he did. I believe that.
Oh, that's for them. No, that's for people that use their faith.
Yes, it is. Come on.
So here is Moses preaching. He got a little bit of swag. And the children of Israel are like, wow, whatever that dude says, it happens. They leave Egypt. I mean, it's an amazing thing. The Bible says that they put the blood on the doorpost. On the inside. It's very fascinating that they had to put blood. You know what the Talmud says? The Talmud says that the Hebrews' houses were so much like the Egyptian houses that God wanted distinction. They were involved in that culture for 400 years, and God's trying to already teach them separation, the blood. So they leave, and it's joyous. It's always awesome when you respond to the preacher.
That's the truth.
Sunday night, preacher said it. Let's shout. Let's dance. Shake the devil down to the ground. Let's dance and shout. I need some help up in here. I had to say that. I tease him so much. So watch this, though. They got out of Egypt because of Moses' faith. They get to the Red Sea. Are you with me? And the first thing they do is like, God obviously is not talking to you. You led us down a valley to the sea, and now we have Joe Pharaoh, devil, coming behind us to kill us, and we got a Red Sea in front of us and mountains on both sides. Great job, Moses. You're awesome. Woo! Did you bring us out here to die? And you know the story. They start blaming Moses because they have not used faith at all. And when you don't use your faith, you become highly critical of other people that do use their faith. Oh, the pastor, he don't know what he's doing. What is he doing? This is so stupid. Oh, another great theme. Oh, God, what is he doing? I know humanity. It's so easy to be a critic. It's easier to be a critic than it is to be a person of faith and say, we're going to the other side. So, you know the story. It's played out. They're like, oh, my God. And Moses is like, he's like, God, I'm a little bit scared myself here. And God's like, Moses, it's not time to pray right now. It's time to move. Moses is like, cool. Gets a stick. He starts going. He stretches out his stick and voila. Wow. Can you imagine? They're like, their mouths were like, he did it again. I mean, I find it amazing. Moses couldn't bury one soldier out of the will of God, but in the will of God, he buries the whole army. His faith back then, but now he's engaged, he's exercising it, he's using it, and he's unstoppable. He's got a congregation that every time they get in trouble, they blame him. But he's so humble, he throws himself down and says, God, please don't have mercy on him. And God says, I'm glad you did that. Now let me take matters into my hand. You stand right there, opens the ground, swallows up a few of them. Let's keep on going. And the people say, whoa, don't talk about Moses. But it's human nature. People just can't help themselves because they're critics. They're not faith-filled. Be a student before you become a critic. Learn, watch, use what you have. So the whole thing, what I'm trying to show you is this. Moses can't do a thing to get them into the promised land. He has delivered them. He has preached to them. He has got them out. And isn't this so like a preacher? I mean, the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 10, they were all baptized unto Moses in the sea and in the cloud, right? The cloud descended, a type of the Spirit. They went through the Red Sea, a type of baptism. He delivered them from Egypt. Friend, he can only take them so far. I can preach to you. I can teach you a Bible study. I can get you to believe the Acts 2:38 message. You can leave Egypt. You can be born again. You can be filled with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. You can be like, yes, I have come through the Red Sea. But you better listen to me right now. You better hear this preacher. If you are going to step into the promises of God, it will not be on his faith. It will be on your faith. When people fall out and they lose out with God, it's not the preacher, it's not the church. Friend, it's their own stinking rotten faith. It's not alive. Judas has the best pastor, the best leader. And he fell short because he didn't care for what God invested in him. Are you hearing me? Oh, we could be doing other things if the pastor would do this. Shut up. Just shut up. It's 2022. Shut up. Find a prayer room. Get some wording. We don't have time to be slowed down by your penny worth little opinion and your lack of faith when there's a world that's on fire. While you complain and while you wear out the ministry, God is looking for somebody that'll wake up, believe, and engage their faith to be a redeemer, to be a savior, to be a place of refuge, to be a house, a temple, a tabernacle, a sanctuary, if you please, of the presence of God. See, no one leaves Egypt without Moses. No one leaves the world without a preacher. Oh my God. See, there's not a lot of respect for the man of God today. The Bible says that preachers are gifts. Ephesians. What is it? I can't remember. Ephesians what? 4 something? 4, thank you. Tells you I'm a good preacher. I was just testing you. Says we're gifts. I'm a gift. God bless you. That sounds kind of awkward. It's weird. It's hard to preach. But there's not a lot of respect for preachers anymore. You know, if a preacher is a token of God's affection for the church, a gift to help, to direct. I mean, Moses was a gift to those Hebrews. He delivered them. But yet the first sign of trouble, they turned on him. If I give my wife a flower and she throws the flower down in disrespect, who is she disrespecting? The flower is just the gift. It's a token. It's not the important part. She's the apple of my eye. The flower is just a token. But if she disrespects the token, she disrespects me. When you disrespect the gift that God gives you, you show your lack of faith in God's ministry, in God's authority, in God's plan. Every time they questioned Moses, God took a step back. Every time they didn't get in line with God's plan, they took a step back. Every time they came up against Moses, God was trying to tell them, this is the man that helped you get out. It was his faith when you were in bondage. Him alone that preached, him alone that prayed, him alone that parted the Red Sea. But here they are at the promised land. Here they are. And there's a spiritual now happening. Hebrews 11:1 says, now faith. We can't get beyond this point. We're at the border of the promises of God. The most difficult time, I said it at the beginning, of your life may be at the border of your promises. Because that's where God says, I know what's in your heart, but do you? You say you got this and you got that, but you don't have action to back it up. And God says, if we're to go through an open door, we can all be up here on our knees and be begging God to open, to take us through. But until your heart burns, until you catch on fire. I told you I was going to come for you. I was 19 years old when I got the Holy Ghost. I thought it was the best thing known to man. It took me 2 months to get the Holy Ghost because everyone told me, as I had orange hair and it was spiked really high, and everybody wanted to put their hand on my hair, and it made me mad. And then they put their hand on my back. Get it to him, get it to him. And I had one brother that would scream in my face, I left one service with no eyebrows because his breath was horrible.
Hear that.
When you get the Holy Ghost, it's going to be like electricity. I was like, electricity. Okay. I didn't grow up in this. I literally went like this a couple times. What are you doing? I'm waiting. I'm laying my tongue before the Lord. I don't know. You people were weird. The only thing I knew about speaking in tongues was a cassette tape that dates me. I had just bought the cassette tape Talking Heads, and the title of the tape was Speaking in Tongues. I said, God's trying to talk to me. But here's the thing. I finally got the Holy Ghost in spite of you. But when I got the Holy Ghost, I told every one of my friends. I told my mom, I told my dad, I told my grandmother, I said, it's real. I can't explain it. I don't know. I got in arguments with pastors. I got called before preachers. And all I knew was, well, it says right here in the book of Acts, if you do what that says, you're going to speak with tongues. I know you're a Jehovah Witness and you say that that's the devil, but it says right here, and I spoke with tongues, and I want you to know I used to be a devil, but honey, I am not a devil anymore. I am full of the Holy Ghost. I don't cuss, drink, smoke stuff. I live for God. I'm on fire, and the passion, it burned in me. I was so discouraged when I found out not everybody believes this. That it gets old. That it gets, it's just the Holy Ghost. Can you imagine? I mean, the Bible says, you can read the story. I don't have time to go into it. But Joshua and Caleb, they're trying to steal the people. No, we are well able. Did you see what happened in Egypt? The miracles, we are well able. The preacher, he's like, come on, you can do this. You can win a soul. Come on, God can bless you. God can do, and you're... Oh, yeah. Ooh. Hey, where are we going to eat tonight?
Yeah.
is looking for the church. Yeah. Yeah. You want a deeper move of God?
Yes.
The Bible says in Ezekiel, the prophecy is that the waters would issue forth out of the sanctuary. And wherever they go, they bring healing. Jesus said in John 7:38, if you believe on me, as the scripture has said, not as your Aunt Sally, Grandma Joe, or Uncle Benny, whoever. No, if you believe as the scripture has said, out of your belly shall flow spirit, water. Ezekiel measured and it was ankle deep. And then it was waist or knee deep. And then it was waters to swim in. The further he got out from the sanctuary, the deeper the water got. That doesn't mean he's not tethered to church. It means he's doing ministry. He's operating in faith. He's not touching the ground anymore. He's out of the kiddie pool. He's out there swimming in the Holy Ghost. And wherever he goes, water. Friend, the Bible says that we're to put on the armor of God. Our feet are shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. That means wherever you step, peace. You step into a situation, someone in your neighborhood arguing, you step in, peace. You step into church, peace. You bring peace. What is peace? Peace is true happiness. Happiness is not found in things. The world is drowning in things. They want peace. And you know who has peace? The church. The church. The church, you have peace. Well, I don't really have any peace. Yeah, because you don't pray. You don't exercise your faith. You don't teach a Bible study. You don't, you know how to worship and put on a tie and look good.
Come on.
But you don't know how to pray down the fire.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, I'm running out of time. See, it's your responsibility. It's my responsibility. God had Moses get those leaders to go into the promised land so those leaders would know what's in their heart.
Yes.
And to set a lesson straight.
Yes.
If we don't do this collectively, we don't do this at all. He can preach all he wants about an open door. He can tell you the promises and you just sit there all. That was some good preaching. We are so fat spiritually. You don't need any more preaching. Don't take me out of context. Pastor said we don't need preaching here. That's not what I mean. You are full. It's like we're like the children of Israel in the wilderness. God gave them bird, pheasant, and it was coming out their nose, coming out their ears. I wish, when I first started preaching, I preached a message, youth pastor. I said, I wish some of you would just vomit up the Holy Ghost on people. They ate so much, they were vomiting out. And yeah, I know it's a stupid analogy, but it works right now. I wish that some of you would just get so much in you that you would just let it come out. But you keep it boxed up because you won't exercise your faith. I am so convinced when you pick up the burden for revival, not just the leaders, when you feel the responsibility of your faith to engage a broken world. Friend, that's when all of heaven is going to come unhinged. Why would God give us miracles, power, signs, and to be a light when we're lackadaisical? If this church was to disappear tomorrow, would there be anybody around here that would even notice? The church is supposed to be the aroma of a kingdom to come. Jesus, when he came into a city, it shook hell and it rattled heaven. And everybody knew it. And don't tell me nobody wants holiness. Jesus was holy. And everybody wanted it. I think somewhere along the way, we've lost our mode. We think we're here to critique the world, tell them how wrong they are. The preacher's job is to point out sin, not your. Your job is to love them. Your job is to bring the kingdom. Your job is to demonstrate the kingdom by showing in power and wonder. Your job is to live a holy life and demonstrate the kingdom. Your job is to have a marriage that gets along and you don't get all sideways. Your job is to keep your family in church and model and open your mouth and tell people. It's to engage collectively. I believe this.
Yes.
The one thing that frustrated Jesus so much, He was amazed at great faith, and he was amazed at little faith. But what frustrated him so much is when the disciples didn't believe they could do what he said they could do. It frustrated him. You've heard it said that we need to believe in God. But I find that God believes in people a lot too. Because he's banking on your responsibility, your duty to your faith. That you'll engage it, your faith. All the way in the back to the front. That you'll say, I'm with you, preacher. You got me out of Egypt. I'm thankful for you. I'm going to pray God blesses you. You preach me the truth. You got me out of the world. But if we are going to step into the promises of God, that's something I have to do with my faith. Getting behind the man of God and moving and pushing and driving this forward. Seeing it happen. It's like tomorrow you wake up and you say, Lord, here am I. Send somebody my way that I can be a witness to. Help me to bring peace to a broken world. Help me to bring light. You called me to be salt. Do you know how small salt is? How many here like tortilla chips? With some guacamole. If you don't have any salt, please sit down. What is a tortilla chip without salt? And you just put a little bit of salt and everything is heightened. Now, I know in the Bible, salt is always used as a preservative. But wonder if salt is also salt. He said if salt has lost its flavor, it's good for nothing. What does salt do? Salt takes boring chips and makes them awesome. Salt heightens everything. You and I are called salt. We are here to heighten life. We don't live a boring life. When they see you, they should say, how is it you have peace in the middle of this Omicron, whatever, junk, COVID? How is it? What is it that your life has? Friend, I've been salted with the Holy Ghost. I've got peace. I've got joy. Oh, not everything's a mess, but I've got peace. And I've got joy. Something they don't have. Friend, my life, your life should be a testimony. That our lives are heightened. He said, I come that you might have life. And that more abundantly. But I find Pentecostals are too. My God, he's still preaching. Not going to be able to get my burrito tonight if he keeps going. I'm sorry. You know, Jesus is counting on you. Do you know this yet? Let me give you a revelation. God is invisible. Did you know that? Did you know God's invisible? You did? So he's here, but you can't see him. Well, if the Son of God was manifest, that means made visible for the purpose of destroying the works of... I mean, Acts 10:38, not 2:38, 10:38 says that Jesus, a man anointed of the Holy Ghost... went about doing good and healing and doing all. It's an awesome verse. You know why? Because it says, as a man anointed. If he did it as God, I'm blown away, but I can't follow. But if he did it as a man, then I have an example. Start with some good works tomorrow. How about being nice to your spouse? Let's start in our own homes. You know what? I'm not going to call you a jerk anymore. Revival! You're not going to have to call the pastor on me anymore. I'm going to live for God now. I'm going to line up. Wow! I know. But see, when we get our act together, we bring a heightenedness to life that just is a saltiness. And that is a testimony. I give you life, and that more abundantly. And the water of the Spirit flows out of us. And wherever it touches, it brings healing. It brings peace. Friend, there are people all around us that want what we have. Promises of God are all before us. A door is open. God told Moses, go get 12 leaders. Go have them spy out the land and see if what I said is not true. But God knew what they'd do. They wouldn't use their own faith. They would try to lean on Moses' faith. Did you bring us out here to die? And 10 men gave an evil, faithless, evil report that hindered a nation. Even though Moses stands there with his rod, And look at the faith of Joshua and Caleb to submit to the leadership, knowing we could have taken the land, but we submit ourselves. God said, I'll wipe them all out. God, Moses says, no. It's a sad document, a sad testament. God could bring them out, but he couldn't bring them in. God can get you out of the world, but if you're going to get the promises, it's up to you. The door is open. You got to walk through the door. You have to be open enough to be vulnerable enough with God. You have to have desire enough to create a prayer life. And you have to be passionate enough to push past the resistance. And you have to give God something to work with. And if you'll use your faith, God will do incredible things. Revelation 3:8, I know your works. Behold, I have set before you an open door. No man can shut it. For you have a little strength, and you've kept my word, and you've not denied my name. But if you're going to walk through that door, it's on you. It's on you. If revival comes to Hilltop, it will be because you obeyed the voice of God through the preacher, and you engaged this world with your faith, and the world came unhinged. I mean, I drive around, I told the church I pastor, it makes me sick. There's all these lines for COVID tests. There ought to be lines for people to get into the house of God because it's a place of healing. Yes, it is. Musicians, I preached long enough. I just saw up there, it says, I'm not going to tell you what it says. I'm done. Musicians, you got to come. Many centuries ago in the land of Israel, you can stand, lived a rabbi. He lived during the Roman occupation. His name was Rabbi Akiba. One night, he was lost in study, and he was walking home, leaving the synagogue in Jerusalem. He lived outside the city. And as he walked, he was in deep thought of his studies, and night had fallen. And normally, he'd come to a fork in the road, and he would go to the right to his house, but he was such in deep thought that he went to the left and he didn't even realize it. And he came up to a Roman guard, a centurion, standing at a gate, and it kind of broke him up out of his thinking. And all he heard was, "Who are you? And what are you doing here?" And he said, "What?" And the centurion said, "Who are you? And what are you doing here?" And he said, "How much do they pay you?" The centurion said, "Who are you? And what are you doing here?" And he said, "No, really, how much do they pay you?" And he was taken back. He kind of said, well, they give me 2 drachma. He said, "I'll pay you 3 if you'll come to my house every day and ask me who I am and what I'm doing here." Who are you? And what are you doing here? Behold, I set an open door before you. No man can shut it. The land flows with milk and honey. There's miracles. The promises are greater works would you do. Can I be honest with you? You and I can't do greater till we do the same. We're not even doing the same. Peter's shadow, Jesus didn't do that. Paul broke up hankies and sent them, Jesus didn't do that. What are we doing? What'd you do in 2021? How did you engage your faith in 2021? And what are you gonna do different in 2022 to go through that door that is set before you? Because there's an open door for this church. I'm not here by accident. There's an open door to this church. Yes. He was teasing me. He was like, "Just come preach. Dude, come preach that. Come preach." And I felt, I promise you, I was reminded of 5 a.m. when I said I was cold. I was thankful for today, but I said, "Lord, whatever you want." And I went. And the freeways were open. And here I am. The door is open. What are you going to do? What are you gonna do? What are you gonna do with your faith? Are you gonna step through the door? Or are you gonna go get a burrito? God bless you.
Why don't we find a place around this altar?